Hi, I'm Meris, and in this video, we're going to be talking about advanced directives and HIPAA. I will be following along with our Fundamentals of Nursing flashcards, which are available on leveluprn.com. If you are following along with me, I am starting on card number 7. So let's get started. All right, let's talk about advanced directives. One of the things that you're going to notice on this card is that we talk first about the Patient Self-Determination Act, and this is the legal act that is actually the thing that guarantees that a patient has the right to make their own decisions about their healthcare. Very important to understand that that's what this document sets up. This is how we are able to have the ethical principle of autonomy. Now let's talk about some different types of advanced directives, and they are what they sound like. It is a patient being allowed to direct their care in advance. So this means that if I am incapacitated or brain dead or something similar, I have already legally expressed my wishes somehow, and we're going to talk about the different ways. This is very important for patients who have specific wishes they wish to be followed. So the first one we're going to talk about is a living will. And a living will is the document a patient draws up which indicates the types of interventions they do and do not want to have if they were incapacitated and unable to provide consent for themselves. So this is very specific. The patient can say, I don't wish to be intubated. I do wish to have tube feedings. I don't want this kind of intervention. That is the document, a living will. Now, a do not resuscitate order is a specific type of advanced directives that says, in the event of cardiac death, I do not want for you to perform CPR. No resuscitative actions, and depending on your state, there may be variations of this, so definitely make yourself familiar with all of the different DNR options available in your state. But if your patient is a DNR and they have a cardiac arrest, we would not begin CPR. So the thing that's important to understand, though, is that we do require physician's orders for life-sustaining treatment to be in place. And this means that the physician needs to actually put orders into the system saying something like do not resuscitate or comfort care only or whatever the patient's advanced directives are. The physician does need to put orders in so that we can, as nurses, carry out those orders. Now, durable power of attorney is something you're going to hear a lot about in nursing school. And this is a legal document that designates another person as being able to make medical decisions for the patient. So for instance, if I had a durable power of attorney, I could say, in the event I'm unable to give consent myself, my husband, my mother, whoever I wish to designate, they have the legal ability to give consent for medical treatment only medical treatment in my stead. There are other forms of power of attorney that allow you to give consent for other things, but not this. Medical care only. The other thing is they don't have to be related to the person. So for instance, I could say, Kathy Parks, you are my durable power of attorney. We are not related, but would you be the one to make healthcare decisions if I could not? So those are very important advanced directives to understand because you will certainly see these come up on your nursing exams. Okay, next we're going to be talking about HIPAA, which is the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. This is very important for you to understand. It's highly testable because it's so important because this is the law that sets forth the principles protecting a patient's privacy when it comes to their medical records. So very important to understand. So we have a lot of things to go over here. I would recommend reviewing this card in depth because this is very testable information. So some things that you need to keep in mind about HIPAA, you are absolutely allowed to discuss a patient's care with other members of the healthcare team who are providing direct patient care, such as their physician or the respiratory therapist. That's okay. What isn't allowable by HIPAA, though, would be something like speaking to a nurse on a different unit about the patient who isn't providing care to that patient. Furthermore, if your patient's spouse wanted information on their lab work or their medicines, that's okay only if the patient has signed a release of information indicating that you are allowed to share that information with that person. So don't give away any of the protected health information of your patients unless you have that written signature saying it's okay to talk to this person. Now, when you do have conversations with other members of the healthcare team, make sure that these are in secure locations, such as the break room or the nurse's station. That's all okay. But don't have these conversations in public areas, such as the cafeteria or in the elevator. That would not be appropriate. Now, when it comes to the electronic health record, EHR, there's some things to keep in mind there, too, as to how to protect their information when you're working on the computer. One of the most important things is going to be your password. You need to use a strong and unique password, change it frequently, and never share that password with anyone, including your own manager. That's very important. When you step away from the computer, you need to log off entirely. It's not enough to just turn off your screen or turn the screen away. That's not allowable by HIPAA. Some other things to keep in mind, you can only access patient charts for the patients that you are directly caring for, so you can't look up charts for a friend of yours or a celebrity that's in the hospital. That's not an okay use of a patient's health record. So that is essentially the best practices around HIPAA. Keep in mind that accidents happen and people do break confidentiality intentionally or otherwise. When that happens, though, you need to hold yourself accountable and hold others accountable and report that breach to your direct supervisor. It's uncomfortable, but it's very important. Okay, so that's it for advanced directives and HIPAA. I hope you found that review helpful. If you did, please be sure to give us a like. You can drop a comment below to let me know what you liked about that video. And it's awesome if you want to subscribe so that you don't miss any of the videos that we put out on lots of different nursing content. Next, I hope you join me. We're going to talk about something that is really important but very tricky. We're going to talk about intentional and unintentional torts, really important concepts, and we're also going to go over mandatory reporting. Thanks so much and happy studying!
I invite you to subscribe to our channel and share a link with your classmates and friends in nursing school. If you found value in this video, be sure to hit the like button and leave us a comment and let us know what you found particularly helpful.